بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم everybody. Welcome back to my channel, Principles of Pharmacology. In today's presentation, inshallah, we'll talk about the pharmacology of antipsychotics, which are used for the treatment of psychosis like schizophrenia and as well in the treatment of affective psychosis. So let us start with the goals of this presentation, what we are looking for at the end of this presentation. We are going to know what are the different classes of antipsychotics, including the first generation, the second generation, and the third generation antipsychotics. We are going to talk about the difference between these antipsychotics and their mechanism of action, and their therapeutic application, and in their side effects profile. So first we'll talk about the classification of antipsychotics. Antipsychotics, generally, they are classified into two major groups. The first is known as typical antipsychotics, or they are known as first generation antipsychotics. And they are known as first generation because they were the first to be introduced in clinical practice. These first generation antipsychotics will include different chemical groups, including the phenothiazines, the thiazanthines, the dibenzabines, diphenylbutyl biberidines, and the butyrophenones. The second group, they are known as atypical antipsychotics because they are differ from the first generation. These atypical antipsychotics, there are two groups. The first is known as second generation antipsychotics and the third generation antipsychotics. They are known as atypical because they differ in some aspects from the first generation or the typical antipsychotics. The second generation includes famous examples like clozapine, like olanzapine, like risperidone, quetiapine. Okay. Third generation includes the most recent antipsychotics introduced into general practice, like aripiprazole, brexpiprazole, and caribrazine. Okay, so these are the different classification of antipsychotics. They are classified into typical, including the first generation antipsychotics, and the atypical, which includes the second and the third generation antipsychotics. So let us start with the first generation antipsychotics. So what's the difference between these different groups? They differ in their potency, as you will see later. They differ in their selectivity to different types of receptors, and as well, they will differ in their side effects profile. So let us start with the typical antipsychotics. اللهم يسموهم the first generation antipsychotics. These typical antipsychotics, they belong to different chemical groups. They belong to different chemical groups. The most famous, the first to be introduced, were the phenothiazines, the mashurat. Second are the thiazanthines. The third, they are known as dibenzabines. Fourth, diphenylbutyl biberidines, and the butyrophenones. Of course, these all, they have different chemical structure and they have different affinity to different types of receptor. Like all of them, they share the property of blocking the dopamine type 2 receptors. And as we have talked in our previous presentation, that dopamine receptors, they are allocated in different parts of the brain in what's known as dopaminergic tracts. So first is the dopaminergic tracts, which innervates the mesolimbic system. By blocking dopamine receptors in the mesolimbic system, this will result in the therapeutic effect, the whole antipsychotic effect. Yeah, the antipsychotic effect results due to blocking of dopamine receptors in the mesolimbic system. Also, they block nigrostriatal pathways, dopamine receptors in nigrostriatal pathway, and this will result in the extrapyramidal side effects, as you will see later, inshallah. Also, they can block dopamine receptor in the tuberoinfundibular pathway, and this will result in an increase in prolactin secretion in a state known as hyperprolactinemia. All these groups, they share the property of blocking dopamine receptors in different parts of the brain, and they produce different side effects, as you will see later. Okay? These drugs also, they are known as dirty drugs. Why? Because they can block other receptors other than dopamine receptors. So they can block muscarinic receptors in different parts of the body, including central and peripheral, and this will produce atropine-like side effects, as we will discuss later. Also, they can block alpha-1 receptors, which are present on certain blood vessels, and this will result in vasodilatation, and the vasodilatation will result in pooling of the blood in the periphery, which will result in postural hypotension or a drop of blood pressure when the person changes his position. Also, they can block H1 receptors, histamine type 1 receptors, which are present peripherally and centrally. Centrally, they can produce sedation due to blocking H1 receptor, and peripherally, they can prevent an allergic reaction. So these first generation antipsychotics, they differ from each other in terms of their affinity to dopamine receptors, muscarinic receptors, alpha receptors, and H1 receptors. So if we draw a table of the classification of first generation antipsychotics, as I have said, they differ in their potency and they differ in their affinity in blocking dopamine receptors type 2, muscarinic receptor, alpha 1 receptor, and histamine receptor. By blocking dopamine receptors, they can produce extrapyramidal side effects, as we will see and discuss in a few minutes. Okay, so the degree of the extrapyramidal side effects, will depend on their potency at the dopamine receptor. The more the potency of blocking of dopamine receptors, the more will be the extrapyramidal side effects. Okay. Some of them, as you will see, they can block a dopamine receptor, and as well they can block a muscarinic receptor. They block a muscarinic receptor. As you can see with this group, aliphatic phenothiazines. They have high affinity to dopamine receptor, and as well they have a higher affinity to muscarinic receptor. In this case, these drugs, which have a high affinity to dopamine receptor and high affinity to muscarinic receptor, they produce low extrapyramidal side effects. Why? Why they produce low affinity, low extrapyramidal side effects? Why? Let me explain that to you. As we know, in the muscle tone, skeletal muscle tone is controlled through the extrapyramidal tract. This extrapyramidal tract starts from the motor area in the cortex and goes down to the nigrostriatal pathway. In the midbrain. So the motor area will send signals through nigrostriatal pathway. This is known as extrapyramidal tract. In nigrostriatal pathway, there are two neurotransmitters. One is acetylcholine, and the other is dopamine. Okay, acetylcholine is excitatory. It means that it increases the muscle tone. Tone which goes to the muscle will be increased, while dopamine is inhibitory. What does it mean, inhibitory? It decreases the muscle skeletal muscle tone. Okay. Yeah, there is certain activity in the motor area, which through the nigrostriatal pathway, this activity will be enhanced by acetylcholine, which is excitatory through muscarinic receptor. This will result in more or increase in muscle tone. Muscle tone will be increased. And as we know, when the muscle tone is increased, the muscle will become more rigid. تولي صلبة شوية. Okay? Now, the other neurotransmitter dopamine is inhibitory through D2 receptors. What does it mean inhibitory? It inhibits the muscle tone. Okay? These two neurotransmitters, they are in balance with each other. In balance. يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى has made a balance between the activity of acetylcholine and dopamine. They are in balance. So the muscle tone will be kept at a certain level, no more nor less. Because why? Why? Because if the muscle tone is high, that the muscle tone, التوتر بتاع العضلة, توتر العضلة لما يزيد, شنو يصير العضلة؟ العضلة تولي متصلبة, يحصل rigidity of the muscle. صح؟ Okay? Now, if the muscle tone is high, this will result in muscle rigidity. ولو المuscle becomes rigidity, what will happen? Movement will become difficult, of course. الحركة هتبقى صعبة. العكس تماما, if the muscle tone is low, معناها المuscle will become flaccid. هتبقى مرخية المuscle. Flaccid. معناها in both cases, what will happen to the movement? In both cases, the movement will be affected. Okay? The posture will be affected, the movement will be affected. So normally, there is a balance between acetylcholine and dopamine. Okay? If acetylcholine activity increases, the muscle will become more rigid. تبقى متصلبة العضلة. If dopamine increases, the muscle will become more flaccid. العضلة تبقى مرخية. ولكن in normal cases, there is a balance between the two. Okay? Okay, now, if I block dopamine receptor, what will happen? If I block dopamine receptors by D2 blocking drugs, dopamine 2 receptor like chlorpromazine, what will happen? Like an antipsychotic, what will happen? In this case, acetylcholine will become predominant. Will take over the activity. معناها muscle tone will be increased. Increase in muscle tone. And if the muscle tone is increased, the muscle will become rigid, and this will result in the extra pyramidal side effects, as we will discuss later. That's why it is known as extra pyramidal side effects. Side effects which result from blocking of dopamine receptors in the nigrostriatal pathway. فسموها extra pyramidal على اسمها, لأن extra pyramidal tract حصلت في extra pyramidal tract. واضح الكلام؟ Okay. So if we block the dopamine receptor, in this case, what will happen? Acetylcholine will become predominant. Acetylcholine is predominant. More muscle tone. If more muscle tone, muscle will become rigid. Movement will become difficult. This is known as extrapyramidal side effects with other effects that we'll discuss in a few minutes. Okay? Voilà. Okay. Now this is when blocking the dopamine receptors. So if I block acetylcholine receptor, what will happen? The opposite. If I block the acetylcholine receptor, معنى dopamine become predominant, معنى muscle tone will be decreased. يحصل decrease of muscle tone. معنى muscle will become more flaccid. Okay? Now, we come to the beginning. Now, a drug which can block a dopamine receptor, وكذلك it can block a muscarinic receptor. يعني it can block dopamine receptors في nigrostriatal pathway اللي اتكلمنا عليها, can block dopamine receptor في nigrostriatal pathway, and as well it will block the muscarinic receptor in the nigrostriatal pathway. يعني both will be blocked. معناها this balance هيكون more or less, هيكون less this balance. This balance هيكون less لأن both are blocked. Dopamine receptors or muscarinic receptor. معنى this balance هيكون less. معنى extra pyramidal side effect هيكون more or less. They will be less. واضح كلام؟ Okay. Yep, the drugs which can block both dopamine receptor or muscarinic receptor they produce small disturbance in the balance between dopaminergic and cholinergic, and therefore they produce less or low extrapyramidal side effects. That's why chlorpromazine والليفوميبرومازين والبرومازين والترايفلوبرومازين اللي هم أليفاتيك أليفاتيك فينوتايزينز low extrapyramidal effect. Why? Because they block both muscarinic and dopamine receptors. They block both. If they block both, معناها in this case this balance هيكون smaller and therefore the extrapyramidal side effect will be less. Okay? واضح الكلام؟ So in this case, the phenotiazines, the aliphatic, they are classified into different classes. The first is known as aliphatic phenotiazines. They are known as aliphatic because they have aliphatic substitution at the position 10, as you can see here. They have aliphatic substitution at the position 10 in the phenotiazine ring. This is the phenotiazine ring, and this is the aliphatic substitution. Okay? So this is the first group, aliphatic. Aliphatic includes chlorpromazine, levomibromazine, bromazine, triflopromazine. These all, they have a high affinity to both dopamine and muscarinic receptor, especially in the nigrostriatal pathway, and this will result in low extrapyramidal effects. Okay, yep, this is the first group, aliphatic phenotiazine. Second group are the biberidine phenotiazines, biberidine. Well, biberidine is like aliphatic, except there is a biberidine ring substitution, biberidine substitution at the position number 10, like thioridazine, mesoridazine, bericizine, bibothiazine. Yeah, these are the biberidine phenotiazines. The same, they have a high potency at the muscarinic receptor and at the dopaminergic receptor. And because of this, they have affinity at both. They produce less extrapyramidal side effect. Like both of them, they are potent blocker of alpha 1 receptor. They produce severe postural hypotension. And they can block H1 receptor centrally and peripherally, and they can produce strong sedation. Okay. Third phenotiazine group, they are known as the biberazine phenotiazines, because they have a biberazine substitution at the position number 10 of the phenotiazine ring. Biberazine. These biberazines, like triflobirazine, or berfinazine. Flofenazine, as you can see, these drugs, they have high affinity to dopaminergic receptor, but they have low affinity to the muscarinic receptor. That means the disbalance at the nigrostriatal pathway will be strong, and this will result in a predominance of cholinergic activity, which will increase in muscle tone, and this will result in strong extrapyramidal side effects. So if somebody asks you, what's the difference between chlorpromazine and, for example, berfenazine? What's the difference? Chlorpromazine will produce low extrapyramidal side effects. Why? Because it can block dopamine receptor and muscarinic receptor in the nigrostriatal pathway, and therefore they produce lower incidence of extrapyramidal side effects. Berfenazine, on the contrary, it blocks only dopamine receptor. It does not block. It has weak affinity to the muscarinic receptor. Therefore, the disbalance will be great towards the favor of acetylcholine, and this will produce strong extrapyramidal side effects. So this is the first group, which are the phenotiazines. So these are the phenotiazines. Second groups, they are known as thioxanthines. With thioxanthines, they are known as thioxanthines because their nucleus resembles xanthines. That's why they are known as thioxanthines. It's a xanthine nucleus with sulfur. That's why they are known as thioxanthines. This includes thioxanthine, ثايوثيكزين، فلوبنتكزول، فلوبنتكزول، والزوكلوبنتكزول، زوكلوبنتكزول. أوكي؟ يبدأ ديس الثايوزانتينز they have a high affinity to dopaminergic receptors. They block dopaminergic receptors in different parts of the brain, and they have a low affinity to the muscarinic receptor. A low affinity to muscarinic receptors. يعني they are like bipyrazine phenothiazines, like this group, bipyrazine, like triflobirazine. In this case, they produce a stronger extrapyramidal side effects, strong, because the disbalance between dopamine and acetylcholine in the nigrostriatal pathway will be towards the favor of acetylcholine. That means more tone in the muscle, more tone of the muscle, more rigidity, and more extrapyramidal side effects. They, like phenothiazines, they have affinity to alpha 1 receptors and to H1 receptors. They can block alpha 1 and H1 to a smaller degree than the aliphatic phenothiazines. Third group are the dibenzabines, and includes the most famous luxazine, clothiazine, these they have a different chemical structure. The same thing, they have an equal, تقريبا, nearly an equal affinity to muscarinic and dopaminergic receptors. As you can see, they have high affinity to dopamine type 2 receptors, and as well they have a moderate affinity to the muscarinic receptor. That's why they produce moderate side effects. However, they have a high affinity in blocking alpha 1 receptors and the histamine type 1 receptor. طبعا, this will result in different action as we will discuss. Next are the diphenylbutyl biberidines, and this includes bimozide, flospiriline. These drugs, they have high affinity at the dopaminergic receptor, but they have weak anti-muscarinic action. They have weak affinity to the cholinergic receptor, and you expect that they will have high extrapyramidal side effects like the thiazanthines. Okay. Lastly, the most potent, اللي هم البيتيروفينونز. Beta-phenones includes very famous examples like haloperidol, like benperidol, like droperidol. These are very famous, very potent antipsychotics: haloperidol, benperidol, droperidol. These drugs, they have high affinity to the dopaminergic receptors, but they have low affinity to the other receptor. يعني they have low affinity to the muscarinic receptor. The muscarinic and the acetylcholine will be higher, and this will produce higher extrapyramidal side effects. يبدأ البيتيروفينونز. If somebody asks you, what's the difference between haloperidol and, for example, thioridazine? What's the difference? Haloperidol has more affinity to the dopaminergic neuron, dopaminergic receptor, but it has lower affinity to the other receptors, like muscarinic, like alpha 1, like histamine receptors. That's why they are more potent. On the other hand, thioridazine, they have a lower affinity, so they have equal affinity to the dopamine receptors and the muscarinic receptor, and that's why they produce less intensity extrapyramidal side effects. Okay? Yep, this is the first class, the third generation antipsychotics. We divided them into four groups: phenothiazines, thiazanthines, dibenzabines, diphenylbutyl biberidines, and butyrophenones. We said they differ in their affinity to dopaminergic, muscarinic, alpha 1, and histamine receptors. And by this affinity, produce different action. They produce different action. So what are the actions? So what are the actions of first generation antipsychotics? This action can be a desirable action. A desired action means that they are of clinical application. Or they can be undesired actions. In this case, they are side effects. desired action by blocking dopamine receptors in the basolimbic pathway. First generation antipsychotics, they can treat positive symptoms of schizophrenia or schizophrenia. They can treat the positive symptoms of schizophrenia. The, as we have known, and as we have said before, schizophrenia, there are a positive symptoms and negative symptoms. Positive symptoms including hallucination, halwasa, whether they are auditory or visual hallucination. They include as well delusions, like a delusion of persecution, awham, awham al-ittihad. These are usually, these positive symptoms of schizophrenia can be treated by antipsychotics. So they decrease the hallucination and they decrease the delusion. Negative symptoms of schizophrenia, including many, like lack of motivation, lack of motivation. يعني a person lack the interest in everyday activity, like working, like going to the school, etc. Also, social withdrawal is a negative syndrome. The person will live in a world of his own, usually with social withdrawal. Also, the lack of expression, lack of emotional expression. A person cannot expression. A person cannot express his emotion, whether it is fear or pleasure or whatever. Plus other symptoms, these are known as negative symptoms. Usually negative symptoms, they are not affected by the antipsychotic drugs. On the contrary, they might be increased. They might be increased. Okay? In the schizophrenia, there are positive symptoms and negative symptoms. Positive symptoms like hallucination and delusion can be treated with antipsychotic drugs, while the negative symptoms, on the contrary, the intensity can be increased. Also, cognition will be affected. Cognition will be affected by antipsychotic drugs. Okay? If the, this is the first, the desirable action, and antipsychotics, they can treat positive symptoms of schizophrenia without affecting the negative symptoms. An undesirable action is are the results of blocking other receptors. As we have said, they can block, for example, alpha-1 receptors, which are present on the blood vessel, and this will result in vasodilatation. Well, vasodilatation, as we know, will result in the pooling تجمع, يعني pooling تجمع الدم في البريفري, pooling of the blood in the periphery, so that when the person changes his posture, الوضع متاعه, الوضع يتغير, when the person changes his posture, blood pressure will drop suddenly, producing what's known as postural hypotension. Yep, this is a side effect. It's not a desirable effect. طبعا, the degree of postural hypotension depends on the affinity of the drug to alpha-1 receptor. The more the affinity of the drug to the alpha-1 receptor, the more is the degree of postural hypotension. A second side effect is dry mouth, blurred vision, constipation, and urinary retention. And these are known as atropine-like side effect, as we have explained before in different places. Atropine-like side effects. Then atropine produce these side effects due to blocking of muscarinic receptor. Muscarinic receptor blocking. Muscarinic receptors blocking. The blocking of muscarinic receptor. Blocking of muscarinic receptor, like for example in salivary gland, will produce dry mouth, decreases secretion of salivary gland, reducing dry mouth. Blocking in muscarinic receptor and eye, producing blurred vision due to mydriasis, decrease vision for the near things. It can produce blocking of dopamine receptors in the smooth muscles of the gastrointestinal tract, producing constipation, or blocking muscarinic receptor in the urinary bladder, producing urinary retention. If the, this is a side effect, which is usually undesirable side effect. Also, these drugs, they can block the histamine receptor. They can block الهيستامين ريسبتور سنترالي and produce sedation. H1 receptor in the central nervous system, they can produce sedation. These drugs, they can produce, due to a central effect, they can produce weight gain. Weight gain. Yani the person will increase in weight. The exact mechanism is not known up to now. Also, they increase excretion of prolactin from the pituitary gland, producing hyperprolactinemia. Hyperprolactinemia. والهايبرprolactinemia in male produces what's known as gynecomastia. Gynecomastia. Gynecomastia means increase in breast size. Increase in the breast size. في male طبعا. Increase in breast size. His breast size will be increased. This is first. On female, it can produce galactorrhea or disturbance of the menstrual cycle. Menstrual cycle will be disturbed. Menstrual cycle in female will be disturbed. يعني يحصل either bleeding or loss of the menstrual cycle. Okay. Yep, these are due to blocking dopamine receptors in the tubulo-infundibular pathway, which will result because dopamine it has inhibitory effect on the prolactin secretion from the pituitary gland. But therefore, if you block dopamine receptors in the pituitary gland, this will result in increasing prolactin secretion, producing hyperprolactinemia and certain effects on males and females. Lastly, by blocking dopamine receptors in the nigrostriatal pathway, they can produce what's known as extrapyramidal side effects. Extrapyramidal side effects. Extrapyramidal side effects. Extrapyramidal جاي من اسمها لأنه due to blocking of dopamine receptor in the nigrostriatal pathway, which is a nucleus present in the extrapyramidal system. The extrapyramidal system, as we know, it controls the muscle tone. So what are the extrapyramidal side effects? What are the extrapyramidal side effects? Extrapyramidal side effects. What are they? They happen according to the time of therapy. Early in the time of therapy, what will happen? Early in the time of therapy, when you block dopamine receptors, as we have explained early, by blocking dopamine in nigrostriatal pathway, we increase the acetylcholine predominance, increase the cholinergic predominance. Then, as I mentioned, there is a balance between dopamine and acetylcholine. So if you block acetylcholine, if we block dopamine, acetylcholine will become predominant, will increase cholinergic predominance, will increase cholinergic predominance, meaning increase the tone of the muscle, increase of the tone of muscle, meaning muscle will become more rigid, increase the rigidity of the muscle. This increase in rigidity of the muscle will result in tremor and difficulty in movement. Tremor and difficulty in movement. As you know, rigidity معناها زي ما قلنا ان المصل سكيلت المصل الهيكل العضلات الهيكلية تبقى صلبة. مادام تبقى صلبة في الحالة هذه التريتمنت sorry in this case movement will become difficult. Okay, if the this is which takes place early in the treatment due to blocking of dopamine receptors in the nigrostriatal pathway. This will result in cholinergic predominance, increase in muscle tone, skeletal muscle طبعا of course, skeletal muscle tone. This muscle will become more rigid, معناها it results in tremor and difficulty in movement. This is first, which takes place early. في other extrapyramidal side effects which takes place late in the therapy. يعني it takes place after long-term therapy, after treatment with antipsychotic for a long period of time. These are known as tardive dyskinesias. Tardive dyskinesia. Tardive dyskinesia. ومن اسمها tardive معناها slow developing activity ودyskinesia معناها involuntary movement. يعني involuntary movement، يعني movements that the person cannot control. Okay, if the type of dyskinesia takes place slowly and it is slow involuntary movement, it takes months to be developed of treatment with strong antipsychotic, with potent antipsychotic drug, and it is involuntary movement. How does this dyskinesia happen? لأننا قلنا في الأرلي يحصل أكينيزيا، يحصل rigidity in the muscle and the movement will become difficult. ولكن later after long term therapy opposite will happen. يحصل involuntary movement. And the person will suffer from involuntary movement as we will say now in a few minutes. Why this happens? The exact mechanism is not known. ولكن they have said that by exposing dopamine receptors to chronic blocking, when we block a dopamine receptor for a long period of time, especially with the potent antipsychotic, what will happen to dopamine receptors? What will happen? They say that dopamine receptors in the nigrous striatal pathway will increase in number in process amenazman upregulation and increase in sensitivity. Process hyper sensitivity, okay? Blocking of dopamine receptor for a long period of time, الجسم يتفاعل, the body will react to prevent this, the effect of this blocking. How the body will react? By increasing number of dopamine receptor and increase the sensitivity of dopamine receptor. سميناها هذه denervation super sensitivity. سميناها denervation super sensitivity. This super sensitivity, if it takes place in nigro striatal pathway, it will result in bad movement, in excessive movement. This involuntary movement can take place in different skeletal muscles of the body. For example, it can take place in the muscles of the face, ولا muscles of the mouth, ولا muscles of the limbs. So what will happen? We start with the face. What are the involuntary movements which can take place in the face? If the muscles of the face becomes contracted or there is excessive movement in the muscles of the face, it produces different symptoms like grimacing. Grimacing, which is a facial expression indication of pain. Grimacing means a facial expression when the person feels pain or disgusted or discomfort. يعني when there is a distress. احنا نسموها عبوس بالعربي. عبوس. The person looks like he is in pain or he is disgusted. يعني مش عاجب الوضع ولا discomfort. That is يسموها grimacing. This is due to involuntary activity in the muscles of the face. ممكن يحصل rapid eye blinking. يعني blinking of the eye itself due to contraction or involuntary contraction on the muscles of the eye. Okay. ممكن ال involuntary activity تحصل in mouth. تحصل in the mouth. فمثلا يحصل tongue rolling very famous tongue rolling in the tongue will be rolled inside the mouth like the person is chewing although he's not chewing actually like the tongue is moving inside the mouth also there is the lip bouncing and other symptoms, including the muscles of the mouth. All these are akinesia. This involuntary muscle activity can take place in the limbs, either the shoulder, the limbs, muscles of the large muscles of the limbs, either, for example, upper limbs or lower limbs. It can produce, for example, shoulder shrugging. shoulder shrugging. It can also produce lips waving, or it can produce finger tapping. وهكذا. هذه all involuntary movement without the control of the patient. Okay. Of course, these all involuntary movement will produce difficulty in the normal activity of the person, like speaking, like in eating, like in walking, etc. يعني because the person cannot control the activity which takes place in the muscles of the body. So what will happen in this case? What will happen? The person would not like to show this activity in front of people. So what will happen? Social isolation will lead to social isolation. Tardive dyskinesia at the end can lead to social isolation. طبعا social isolation will increase the problem of the person himself. Tardive dyskinesia usually it is difficult to treat. Usually it should be avoided. يعني once the person feels the very beginning symptoms of tardive dyskinesia, he should consult, of course, the physician. Usually treatment of tardive dyskinesia usually treatment is done by different drugs. Some of them they are off-label use, يعني they are not approved by the drug authority like the FDA. Or some of them they are approved. For some of the off-label use, including anticholinergic drugs, atropine-like drugs. طبعا, these drugs are not very effective. In fact, sometimes they produce more damaging effect, like beta blockers, like benzodiazepines, especially clonazepam. Okay, yeah, that these drugs they are off-label use. يعني they are used sometimes in treatment of certain symptoms of tardive dyskinesia. But I can be usually a treatment, as I have said, it is very difficult once it takes place. And sometimes it is irreversible. You cannot reverse it even if we stop the antipsychotic drugs. There are FDA-approved drugs, which are approved only about 10 years ago or something. They like valbenazine, which we talked about it before, which is a vesicular monoamine transporter 2 inhibitor. It inhibits vesicular transport of monoamines. Therefore, they will lead to dopamine depletion. معناها they will decrease chance of super sensitivity. Okay, if that these drugs FDA approved like valbenazine, we talked about it before, it can inhibit vesicular monoamine transporter, which transports monoamines in the nerve ending, and by inhibiting these they will lead to dopamine depletion, and therefore they will decrease the symptoms of tardive dyskinesia. But this use, as I have said, it still should be done under very close medical supervision. Yep, this is the first, which are the first generation therapeutic use in treatment of positive symptoms of schizophrenia. They have very several side effects, including postural hypotension, dry mouth, blurred vision, constipation, urinary retention. These side effects will produce what's known as low compliance, and the patient would not like these side effects. So usually the compliance of patient with these drugs is very low. Then the patient would not like to feel, for example, dizziness due to postural hypotension, or constipation, or whatever. Okay. So usually these drugs, there is low compliance. How we can avoid this low compliance therapeutically? How? First, by education. We should educate the patient about the side effects. Yani the patient should be informed about these side effects. We should be told that if that has happened, don't worry, this is a common side effect which will disappear. And the patient, of course, should be educated about the extrapyramidal side effects. Once they start happening, he should tell his doctor to try to avoid the severe consequences of tardive dyskinesia. Also, should be regular monitoring for the patient from his physician. Also, there should be a supportive therapy by counseling. And lastly, we use long-acting injectable antipsychotic. Why long-acting? If the patient misses his oral doses, he might get his schizophrenia might get worse. So in this case, we prefer using long-acting injectable versions of first-generation antipsychotics. Okay, yeah, this is first-generation antipsychotics, which are out of favor nowadays. But we have to know about their pharmacological action. Because of all these side effects and low compliance, physicians now, they prefer using atypical antipsychotics. This includes examples like clozapine, most famous, clozapine, olanzapine, risperidone, quetiapine. Why they are known as atypical antipsychotics? Because they act by mechanisms different from the first generation typical antipsychotics. How they do that? They act by blocking two types of receptors. They can block dopamine type 2 receptors, and also they block 5-HT2A receptor. Okay, therefore they have affinity to D2 receptors in different parts of the brain, and as well they block 5-HT2A receptor. They said that by blocking these two receptors, they produce less extrapyramidal side effects. They produce less extrapyramidal side effects like a tremor, like a tardive dyskinesia, which we have described before. So why they produce less extrapyramidal side effects? These are, as we have explained, they are very bad side effects. They are intolerable from the patient. So why they produce less extrapyramidal side effects? They said that they produce that because they block these two types of receptor, D2 and 5-HT2A. So what happens? Just imagine this is the nerve ending, dopamine nerve ending, which stores dopamine and releases dopamine. Dopamine, when it is released, it will act on both synaptic receptors. On this nerve ending, there are specific types, 5-HT2A receptors. There are receptors. These receptors are known as heteroceptors or heteroreceptors. What means heteroreceptor? That means they inhibit, they have a negative effect on the release of dopamine. They inhibit the release of dopamine, okay? That's why they are known as heteroreceptors. You have the 5-HT, by stimulating the 5-HT2A receptor, it will inhibit the release of dopamine, like dopamine does to its own release through the autoreceptors. Autoreceptors, they are presynaptic receptors present on the nerve ending. There are D2 receptors which are present on the nerve ending. Therefore, D2 receptors that are present on the nerve ending to control the release of dopamine by inhibiting the release of dopamine, and as well, these are known as autoreceptor, and as well, there are 5-HT2A receptor, which are known as heteroreceptors, which inhibit the release of dopamine as well. Okay? Okay, now, so if we suppose that this nerve ending is present in the nigrostriatal pathway, through which muscle tone is controlled. If we block this receptor, if we block a 5-HT2A receptor, what will happen? If we block this receptor, then a negative inhibition of dopamine release will not be acting. Mana bihasal increase the release of dopamine. Okay, I repeat it again. So in nigrostriatal pathway, if we block the 5-HT2A receptor, if we block this receptor, mana we remove a negative inhibition of release. Mana in this case, dopamine release will be increased. If dopamine increase, dopamine release increase, معناها tone of the muscle will be decreased, inhibited tone. لأن قلنا dopamine is inhibitory to the muscle tone. معناها decrease in muscle tone معناها less extra pyramidal side effect. Extra, less extra pyramidal side effect. لأن all the effect which takes place in nigrostriatal pathway is due to blocking of dopamine receptor or lack of dopamine activity. واضح؟ Okay. So I repeat it again. يبدأ this atypical antipsychotic they block D2 receptor and also they block 5-HT2A receptor. If they block D2 receptors in mesolimbic system, they produce antipsychotic effect as we have explained, which is the therapeutic indication. And by blocking L5-HT2A receptor, which are present in the nigrostriatal pathway, which are known as heteroreceptors on the dopaminergic neuron, they will lead to increased dopamine release, which means decreasing the tone of the skeletal muscle, which means less extra pyramidal side effects. So that's why these drugs, they produce less extra pyramidal side effects. However, these drugs, they don't only block a D2 or 5-HT2A receptor. They also block other types of 5-HT receptors. They can block a 5-HT2C receptor. 5-HT2C receptor. These receptors are blocked specifically by clozapine and olanzapine. Yani others, they don't block this receptor. Clozapine and olanzapine, they can block a 5-HT2C receptor. This will result in hyperglycemia or increasing glucose living in the blood and produce hyperlipidemia, increase the levels of lipid in the blood. Okay, these are bad effects. They are side effects. They are not desirable effects. Okay, you have the clozapine and olanzapine. By blocking the 5-HT2C receptors, they produce hyperglycemia and hyperlipidemia, which are side effects, not desirable effects. So, okay. Also, these drugs then can block the H1 receptor in the brain and periphery, H1 receptor, especially clozapine, olanzapine, and guaifenesin. They block the H1 receptor. This will result in sedation and weight gain. Sedation and weight gain. Okay. You have these drugs. By blocking the H1 receptor, they can produce sedation due to blocking the H1 receptors, the histamine type 1 receptors in the brain, they produce sedation, and they can produce weight gain. Also, these drugs, they can block an alpha 1 receptor, which are present on the blood vessel. And this will result, especially by clozapine with risperidone. Clozapine with risperidone can block an alpha 1 receptor. As you can see, there are different actions. They are different side effects according to the drug. So by blocking the alpha 1 receptor in blood vessels, especially by clozapine and risperidone, they produce postural hypotension. They produce postural hypotension, as we have explained before. Okay. Yeah, these are the common side effects of these atypical antipsychotics. The clozapine, on the other hand, it produces a granulocytosis. Produces a granulocytosis, which is a rare but fatal side effect. A granulocytosis, that means they inhibit, they produce bone marrow depression, and they inhibit the production of white blood cells, especially granulocytes. So in this case, what will happen? They can inhibit immunity of the system to bacterial and fungal infection, and this is very dangerous. Therefore, when clozapine is used, nowadays, it's not used. There are other alternatives. But when it is used, it should blood monitoring a blood count. When clozapine is used, monitoring blood count is a must. Okay. If these drugs usually, they are second choice, as we will see later, clinically. Why? Because they produce less extra pyramidal side effects. ولكن they produce more metabolic defects. Defects than the first generation antipsychotic. And the first generation antipsychotics, they don't produce hyperglycemia because they have no effect on the 5-HT2C receptors. But therefore, they produce no hyperglycemia or hyperlipidemia. لكن they can produce sedation as we have said, they can produce postural hypotension. Yeah, the metabolic effects of the second generation should be taken care of. Still better are the third generation antipsychotic, third generation antipsychotic, which are atypical because they act by a specific mechanism of action, as you will see. These are the latest introduced in clinical practice of psychosis and includes examples like aripiprazole, aripiprazole, brexpiprazole, cariprazine. These are the examples of the third generation antipsychotics. How they act? They say that they have more affinity to 5-HT2A receptor than D2, opposite to the second generation. The second generation, they block D2 more than 5-HT2A. These drugs, they block, they have more affinity to 5-HT2A receptor than D2. Meaning they will increase the availability of dopamine and the nigrosriatyl pathway more. So in this case, they produce less extrapyramidal side effects, less extrapyramidal side effects. Okay, if they produce less extrapyramidal side effects, why? Because they have more affinity to 5-HT2A receptor than affinity to D2 receptor. Therefore, they will increase the availability of dopamine in the nigrosriatyl pathway, and this will inhibit the muscle tone, and therefore they will produce less extrapyramidal side effects. More than that, these drugs, they have partial agonist activity at D2 receptor. They have partial agonist activity at D2 receptor. Yani they act as a partial agonist. Before we have explained before that the partial agonist will act as an agonist when the activity is low. So when dopaminergic activity is low, these drugs will produce, will act as an agonist when the dopaminergic activity is low. Like when the dopaminergic activity is low in the nigrostriatal pathway, they act as an agonist. And they will inhibit the muscle tone more, and therefore they will produce less extrapyramidal side effects. So we expect that the third generation is better in choice. Why? Because they produce less extrapyramidal side effects. How? By acting on 5-HT2A receptor, increasing dopamine release, and as well when dopaminergic activity is low, they act as an agonist at the D2 receptors, especially in the nigrostriatal pathway. That's why they said that these drugs, they normalize dopamine signaling in the brain. So if dopamine signaling is low, they will act as the full agonist and increase dopaminergic activity. If dopaminergic activity is high, they will act as an antagonist. Okay, this is very good property of these drugs, and this is one of the examples when partial agonist is used in treatment of different illnesses. Okay, these drugs as well, they can block H1 receptor, and therefore they can produce sedation and weight gain, like other antipsychotics. Also, they can block alpha 1 receptor, and they can produce postural hypotension. But I can still, these drugs, they can block as well muscarinic receptor. Okay, the second generation, they don't block the muscarinic receptor, but the third generation, they can block the muscarinic receptor, and they can produce atropine like side effects, including dry mouth, blurred vision, constipation, urinary retention, etc. Okay, if these drugs, they act as an antagonist at 5-HT2A receptor and dopamine receptor, they can act as an agonist at dopamine receptor, partial agonist, when dopaminergic activity is low. They can block the H1 receptor, alpha-1, and muscarinic. So this third generation now, they offer a better choice for the clinician for the treatment of psychosis, or especially schizophrenia and affective psychosis. Why? Because of tolerability. They have less extrapyramidal side effects. They have reduced risk of weight gain. And they have a high efficacy. يعني المردود حيكون عالي in the treatment of psychosis. Okay? Yeah, these are the three different groups which are used in treatment of psychosis. The first generation, the second generation, and the third generation. We talked about their difference in pharmacological action and side effect profile. So what are our conclusion? What we are going to conclude in summary of what we talked about? First, we have to know that the current therapy of schizophrenia is a combination of drug use, antipsychotic medication, or psychosocial intervention and support services. And it's not only drug therapy. And it is a combination of psychosocial intervention, support services by the community, and the use of drugs. Drugs only will not be effective. Choosing the right antipsychotic depends on the individual symptoms. Each person will respond differently to the different classes of antipsychotics. The third generation, they are primary, they are a dopamine antagonist. They produce extrapyramidal side effects. Also, they have atropine-like side effects. They can produce postural hypotension, sedation, and hyperprolactinemia. On the contrary, the second generation antipsychotics, they block both D2 receptors and 5-HT2A receptor. This effect will result in less extrapyramidal side effect. ولكن they can produce hyperglycemia and hyperlipidemia, which are side effects of course, not desired actions. The third generation antipsychotics, they are the better choice nowadays because they have higher affinity to serotonin receptors, especially 5-HT2A receptor. They increase the availability of dopamine at certain parts of the brain. And as well, they will act as a partial agonist at the dopamine receptors. When the dopaminergic activity is low, they will act as the antagonist, and therefore they produce less extrapyramidal side effects, reduced risk of extrapyramidal side effects. Okay, they are the best choice nowadays. At the end, I would like to thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoyed this presentation, and I close up with the verse from the Quran, وفي أنفسكم أفلا تبصرون. صدق الله العظيم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
شكرا لكم على حسن الاستماع. الرجاء لا تنسوا الاشتراك في القناة، الإعجاب، التعليق، والمشاركة مع الزملاء. دمتم بخير وعافية، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.